Welcome to the 2 Month Review, the weekly podcast brought to you by Open Letter and 3%, in which you take one book, break it down section by section, bit by bit, talk about it, analyze it, have fun, make jokes, do all sorts of things. I'm Chad Post from Open Letter Books, and this season right now, the second part of this 12th season, is going to be covering 4x4 by Sara Mesa, translated from the Spanish by Katie Whittemore. And as you'll see, I'm not, if you're watching this live, I am not joined by our regular co-host, Brian Wood. He sent me a message. He said, Chad, I know that baseball is coming back and that you are going to talk about baseball the entire hour, and I don't want to fucking listen to you talk about baseball, so you're doing this on your own. Which is, thank you, Ryan. Thank you. Baseball is back, kind of, and I'm not getting excited for it. I don't think it's going to happen. Anyways, joined instead by special guest, Max Besora. Besora. We just practiced it.
From Iraq.
No. Who is the author of Adventures and Misadventures of the Extraordinary and Admirable Joan, Orpí, Conquistador, and founder of New Catalonia, which will be coming out from Open Letter in January, and that we will have galleys of by the end of the summer. So everyone who's listening, that'll be a good treat. And we'll talk about the book. Well, why don't you give me an elevator pitch for your book right now, since we were talking about it.
The what? The
like an elevator pitch. Like, what is Adventures and Misadventures?
Well, it's a real story about a man who was from Barcelona, Spain. Well, not Barcelona, but a village nearby. And in the 17th century, he went to America, to Venezuela, in fact, or what Venezuela was back then. And he raised a new city there in the middle of the jungle called Barcelona. So he made a second Barcelona city. And I thought that was a very interesting story that nobody knew about it. So I made a novel.
you are underselling parts of this too.
Oh, yeah. I'm not a good seller. You're the publisher.
I can say that it's one of the most inventive linguistic books I've ever read. And in translation, it's wild. Like it is, it's very much like a sort of faux historical novel in a lot of ways. Like we've talked about John Barth's Sotweed Factor or Mason and Dixon, where there's like anachronisms, but there's also like so much play, so many funny jokes, so much. And like all the way that people talk is like fake 1600s speaking. So it's like,
Yeah, that's true. Actually, John Barth's Sotweed Factor is a novel that I had in mind when I was reading this, but also the Don Quixote of Cervantes. Oh, yeah. Or Rabelais, for example.
Definitely Rabelais.
Gargantua and Pantagruel. I don't know how it's called in English.
Pantagruel, yeah.
Oh, Pantagruel, okay. And yeah, and I try to do a lot of different way of talking, 17th century talking in Spanish, Catalan, but also Venezuelan slang from 20th century. So I mix it up, Spanglish too. So for the translator, which is Mara Lethem, she had to create also a new language when she translated this book. And so she did an admirable job and absolutely crazy. Yeah.
It's like she's swinging for the fences with this, and it's wild. And like, not just inventing one language, but languages, because it's not consistent. It's not like she made like one set of rules and can follow that. It's like, that gets tuned up and ratcheted to be funny in whatever way would make it funnier. But it's a really good book. And I think people are really going to like it quite a bit.
I think she wrote a new book, you know, because she didn't have to be only a translator, but a writer. You know, she had to create all these languages and all the jokes, because jokes and humor is also very cultural.
Yeah.
And, you know, what it's funny in Catalan, maybe it's not funny in Spanish, and it's not funny either in English, you know. So that's very difficult to translate when you have a humor book with all the jokes.
I have to tell you, given like the shit that is 2020, I am so looking forward to spending a month just trying to edit your book and make it as funny as possible. This is a joy. But anyway, so we should turn to Sara Mesa and 4x4. And I want to ask you a question. So you know, why don't we talk about Sara generally for a second? So what is her reputation in Spain, and how familiar are you with her work? And
I didn't read anything from her except this book, Cuatro por Cuatro. We met, I think, 3 years ago in San George. We have a big celebration on the 23rd of April, mm-hmm. where we sell a lot of books in the street. Everybody is happy and in love, and we sell roses and books. And we some people got us together with Sara. We didn't know each other, and we talk about literature, and but we didn't read our books each other. So, you know, we were talking about general things about how we understand literature or how we create our books, but we really didn't read each books, you know. And now I read her, and you know, I can say that she's amazing, you know. But she's very well known in probably she's well known as one of the best writers right now in Spain, you know, as a young Spanish writer.
Yeah.
Like, for example, another writer I can say is Cristina Morales, which is also, right. She won 2 years ago the same award that this book won, you know.
Oh, I know. This is an in-joke. Shit, I can't even make this in-joke. But if a certain person is listening, they know what the joke would be. But we almost published that book. Oh. Easy reading.
You should.
Someone else bought the rights out from address.
Oh, she's so good, huh?
Yeah.
And well, but Sara Mesa is also on the same, you know, I consider these two writers probably the best writers in Spain right now. I mean, not that I know a lot of writers, but, you know, these two are really well considered. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I love, like, we're doing Carta de Pan next by Sara, and then her stories for sure, Mala Letra. And like all that I've read Carta de Pan, we're editing it right now. Or I just finished editing it and going to enter all the changes and all that kind of stuff. But and I've read a number of the stories, but her writing is so sparse and direct and amazing. And it's like it's refreshing to read in comparison to a lot of other things. And going back through this has been really interesting to see, like, to hold the final book is crazy for like any of these processes, but this one in particular, because it was a lot of like working on it with the translator in person and like talking, reading it out loud. And so I mentioned this to you, but I'm going to mention it here, is that I didn't reread it for this podcast. Instead, there's an audiobook that came out last Tuesday. So I bought the audiobook and listened to the first part read by a professional narrator. His name I'm blanking out on, I could find it. But it was the craziest experience to me, because we did, in the editing process, we did read aloud most all of the book, if not the entire thing, to try and get like the voices right and make sure it sounded very natural and flowed really well. And hearing then another person reading it, I could hear in my mind the original, I could hear Katie reading it along with this person reading it. And then there'd be certain word choices where I was like, I remember the conversation where we made that specific change. Oh, wow. Or it hit those sections where I was like, oh, this is one of the ones that we went over like 14 times. Like, I wonder how it sounds. And then she'd read it and be like, oh, that sounds good. That sounds great. Like,
well, I guess you know every corner of this book. I mean, if you had to edit that book, no. But I don't know, to be truth, I never heard an audiobook.
Oh,
know?
Wow. Yeah.
How is that? It's like a movie. I mean, do they put music and stuff or what?
It depends. There are ones I've heard that are like truly performed. Like, I think, like, yeah, I might be wrong about this, but I think like the Tolkien sort of books, I think they really like act those out. And there are ones that are like performances, but this one's like, they've got a female reading this section and a male reading the next section, because of the narrator's voices. And she does have like some sort of kind of voice modulation for the, like the headmaster or for the booty or for the advisor. But it's not dramatic, it is read as if you are performing it, as if you're reading it as a monologue rather than just like a flat reading. Like, you're adding to it, and like there's pauses and you hear it. And it's like, it was a great new way to experience a text, to hear it in that way and not just like as my own reading.
But it seems with the audiobook that we are returning before, you know, the Middle Ages, where people were reading all loud for everybody because people didn't know how to read. So the one who knew how to read, they read it for everybody. No, it's like this. The audiobook is like a returning to the past somehow.
That's true. So, I thought you were going to go in the direction of like, because most children these days are like only using TikTok and like writing like as few letters and characters as possible.
They don't know how to read anymore, huh? That's good.
They do. Some of them do. I have kids, and one of them definitely knows how to read. And she almost came on this podcast. The other one, it's a question. It's a big question.
Next time.
Next time, for sure. For sure. So the so what did you think of it? So this is your first experience, and you read just the first part, which for anyone paying attention that doesn't have this, the first part, part one, is never more than 200, and it's the first like 82 pages of the book, or 86. It's basically the first third almost exactly. And it has two storylines, which we can get into, one of which is mostly about Celia and is in a first person sort of mode. And then there's a third person one that's more about Ignacio and especially his relationship to Hector. But the way those two tie together, we'll get to in a second. I'm just curious about your like general impressions first.
Well, I read only until the 80 page or something.
Yeah, perfect.
But yeah, I think the style is very like dry, you know, like short sentences, not many description, like almost like a haiku, you know. It's like, you know, it's the minimum expression. It's a minimalist. I think Sara, I don't know the other books, but in this one, it's very minimalist, which is nice to read it and easy to read because, you know, the chapters are very short too. It's like 2 pages long and then you jump onto the next chapter and it creates this mystery that you don't know exactly what's happening in there. You know, you have this college and all this bunch of girls and boys, no, placed it there. This college is in the middle of nowhere. And some girls try to run away at the beginning of the novel. No, the action starts like this. But then, you know, you can see that, you know, you don't, I mean, I think Sara uses that technique that says show, don't tell, you know. And he only explained things, but you don't really don't know what is going on there, you know, between the relations between the students and also the director and his second worker, which is a woman, which is in by the way, in English, I don't know, but in Spanish the name of the woman, according to Celia, it's la culo. Culo, it means the ass. I don't know how it's been translated that, but.
I don't know if the translator will be able to come on. She'll be on hopefully in a future episode. We did a couple events together and we talked about this quite a bit. And I don't want to put words in her mouth, but part of the problem was that it was initially going to be the ass, but that would sound really weird in English. Like just calling someone the ass is like, it's that it has too many other meanings to it. So it had to be like a part, like an anatomical description of the ass that was also like implying like a sort of sexuality, but also like something other than that. And so that's where she came up with the booty. I think teeny is also a different nickname in Spanish than teeny. Because like, it isn't just, I forget what, like, you might not even know because you have the Spanish version. So her friend that's always got the snotty nose, that's always rom-com. So in the English version, she's called Teeny, but I think she's got a different nickname in the Spanish.
Because also all the names of the novel are very Spanish. So I don't know if you guys translate the names to English names or you just let
them. No, not unless I'm forgetting something entirely, but it's Celia, Valen, you know, Ignacio, Hector, all those are the same. Just the ones that have nicknames that we had to try and play with a little bit, but that wasn't too bad. So there are the two storylines and they intersect and play off of each other in ways, but it might make more sense to go through like Celia's and then Ignacio's, since chronologically that's what actually happens. Although you do not know that right away. And I remember the first time reading this, like, trying to figure out like things are piecing together, but something felt off. And then when I got to the last part and it's like, oh, Celia's gone and Hector replaced her. So that whole story of Ignacio and Hector is coming after Celia's story and leaving the college was like, blew my mind for a second.
I
was
I didn't realize that frame of time.
So this is like for anyone. So this is the thing. So we'll start at that point then and maybe work backwards. But yeah, so they have their first encounter. So they meet on page 80. So Celia's still there at the welcome party for new students. One of the new students is Ignacio, and it talks about his limp. And then when it has the new boy, if you go back and, well, if you go to Never More Than 200, the last chapter, they talk about allowing this new boy in the place of Celia. And the new boy, going back to the very beginning, is where Hector is introduced, and Ignacio immediately has his attraction to him.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
And so you have like, and this, what makes it so interesting where how it's structured in here by reading it in parallel is that you see one set of like abuse in which Celia as a female is treated in a certain way, and her struggle with the power is like one thing, and Ignacio's relationship to Hector and to the headmaster is like taking someone in a different position, abusing them in a different way, but kind of in a, and this is foreshadowing and I don't want to give anything away, but grooming him in a way that Celia is not groomed. Like if and this will make more sense next week, but Celia is just broken. Like, and what happens to Celia at the end is like unstated in a lot of ways. But
Celia is also, she comes from a different background of, yes. I mean, no, the school is segregated by, first of all, by girls and boys. Yep. So they don't go into the same classes, yep. No? And also they are segregated by class because some people are rich. I mean, some students come from a rich family and some students come with a grant.
Yes.
Because their families are poor, no? And even some of the mothers of these poor students, they work in the school as maids, cleaning and stuff. And I think Celia comes from one of these backgrounds, no? With the tough streets and,
yeah.
And she knows, like, you know, the tough life in a way.
Right. So in the mythos of Sara's world, Cardenas, Celia's from Cardenas, which you know, I think it's actually a real town, but it's not the town that's in this book, obviously. But Cardenas is like falling into ruin and like everything's falling apart. There's like crazy shit happening. It's never quite clear, but it feels like just like a complete societal breakdown, like an anarchist moment. And then this is related to a town named Vado, which is referenced in the section as having been there before, but is gone. And Vado, I believe, is the focal point of the novel An Invisible Fire, which is an earlier book of Sara's. And that's the story of why this town goes away, is erased. And like a similar thing's happening now in Cardenas. So Celia's from Cardenas, but she's the only one of the 20 specials. So there's like a certain number of specials who get in that are the scholarship students and the rich, you know, ones. But it's kind of like all still tongue in cheek with the rich ones. Like they're always like, the school's not really, it's not really old. It's not really like that prestigious. It's like, it pretends to be, but like.
Exactly. Well, it's been said between the lines that, you know, the Mrs. Culo, I don't know in English.
Yeah. Let's just call her Mrs. Culo. That's fun.
Yeah. Mrs. Culo is cool. She says to the director, oh, you think people are wondering what's going on here, you know, as if they were hiding something, no? But you don't really know what's happening there. I mean, but it seems like it's something obscure. Something is going on, you know? And yeah. At the same time, you have all these sexual relations between the boys. Like, you know, like Ignacio is like, you know, even almost raping some of the students of his age, you know? And nobody says anything, and that's weird.
That is the big twist. So, like, if when I say grooming, the way that I mean that is in the sense that I have to decline this phone call. In the sense that, like, he's kind of put in this position of weakness and like abuse, like where especially an actor the first time is like suck my dick and like or suck my penis. I don't remember. So suck my dick, we'll say. And like he becomes then be like, oh wow, Hector's, you know, saving me. This is great. And then that all doesn't work. And the headmaster treats him with like, gives him those gifts, but is also like doing something weird with him, like as like getting some sort of comfort from Ignacio, whatever. But then at the very end, Ignacio is like reenacts the scene that happened with Hector from the beginning, where he goes and tries to like, tells the other boy to suck his dick and is like now in the position of like, that's the role model that he's evolved into, or that's the role that he's trying to evolve into.
Which is- yeah, what is strange is that I didn't saw yet in the book that because, okay, this is an English board school, but if it was like a board school in Spain ruled by, I don't know, some religious people, you know, we have real cases that, you know, boys who were in there, they got sexual abused by, you know, so that could be like a parallel of a real world. I don't know.
Absolutely. There's nothing, it's so weird because the book is, the book's clearly fictional, but like at the same time, doesn't feel like imagined in a sense. There was one of our big fans, Jeremy Garber from Powell's, when he, I saw him a couple months ago before the quarantine stuff, and he had read 4x4, loved it. And he was saying that just that, like that week earlier in Portland, they had one of these private schools that was busted for like a ton of child abuse and sexual scandal stuff. And he's like, it immediately, I was like, it's just like 4x4.
There was a movie some years ago called Light Spot about that, all the religious, you know.
Oh, yeah.
About ways. But, you know, I also see parallels with this novel with, I don't know if you ever read Jacob von Gunten by Robert Walser.
Of course.
And it's also a novel about a guy who goes to a board school and you don't know what's going on, but you know, the only thing that they learn in that school, it's to surf, you know, they just learn how to surf. And then you have all these relations also between the director and his second, which is also a woman. And, you know, I could compare these two novels because they use the same thing, which is power relations. At the end, this novel is about power relations, no? Oh, yeah. Between the director with the Miss Culo and the director with the students, and between the students, and who has the power among who. And that's very interesting.
And like, yeah, and taking Celia's story for 1 second, picking up that same thread, there's also the power relationship between the advisor and Celia, and the advisor and the Miss Culo, the booty. Their relationship has some fraughtness too, because she doesn't want him being with Celia or being with the specials, and she even tells on him essentially to the headmaster. So there's another dynamic there. But with Celia's one, so she's from that town from Cardenas, but like her mom isn't working there. Her mom's like living in that like rundown shitty apartment. So she's like a special. And they reference several times that she's there because she's smart, like really smart. And so she's also the willful one who's like, I want to get out of here. I don't, this isn't good. And whereas like the rest of the whole setup with their, or the pitch that they're selling is that this is a closed-in community where your kids will be safe from the chaos of the outside world. And she's in there being like, no, this isn't safer. This isn't safer at all.
Yeah, but that's the main subject. I mean, one of my, the thing I study for my PhD research was on campus novels.
Oh, no way. Oh, that's amazing.
And this could be, among other things, this novel of Sara Mesa could be a college novel, which is The Catcher in the Rye or even Harry Potter, you know. But in the high level, which is the campus novel, the academic fiction, we could say, all the novels has the common thing that there's a college or a university which is far away from society, you know, in the middle of the forest. Because, you know, this is the ideal of nature and civilized nature and where people can be educated in a high level, but also is a way to, you know, control people, control their behavior. And at the same time, you know, you are building the people who will live in the future world, no? And so there is a lot of this literary genre that's going on Sara Mesa's book too, you know, because it's all about power relations and, you know, for example, you know, it raises questions like it's better to live free, but, you know, unprotected by the government or the rules of the society, which is in that case is the director of the center, or it's better to be, you know, controlled by these rules, but at the same time protected, which is, you know, probably the 90% of population, human population, prefer to be controlled by their governments and at the same time to feel more protected, you know. But this paradox is in that book too, you know.
Absolutely. I found that right here. I'll read how we have it translated to have, because I know that this was one of those sections where it's like we tweaked it a lot. So the Spanish that you have is maybe going to be slightly different than ours, but like it's the same exact concept that you're talking about, but it was hard to get it right. So here's the paragraph. It's on 866. Protection as a concept, he says, a concept we will discuss further next class. Protection and security versus freedom. Is that choice even possible today? How do the scales tip in either direction? Is it better to be free and vulnerable or protected but under control? I'll leave it there till next class. That's it. Last night I was watching Westworld, and before I fell asleep, I wrote this down. This is a quote from a recent-ish episode of Westworld. So which one is it? Are you free and evil or blameless and helplessly enslaved? I was like, oh, shit. It's like 4x4, but with robots and murdering people. This was not with robots and murdering people.
No, but
yeah. You said with a campus novel, this is a spoiler of sorts, but with a campus novel, like, it is very much a campus novel. It also sort of calls to mind, like, The Secret History is another one that sort of fits in that kind mm-hmm. of vein of, like, a certain group of people within their machinations. But the second part that's for next week is a journal. So it's like, it takes a different form of like a journal novel. I was going to say epistolary, but that's not right. But like the novel as or journal as novel.
It's that a genre? Yeah, I guess. Like Anne Frank's. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, and I know that there are other examples, but none of them are going to come to me right now. I have no idea. But yeah, so Celia wants to get away. And then she uses she makes a deal with the advisor to take her back to Cardenas. But this is an exchange. And like the exchange, and one of the things you're saying about how smooth and how her prose is so clear and crisp and minimal. And like a lot of it is between the lines or just happening off page. And like all of her conversations with the advisor, we only see a glimpse of them. And then hear like what Celia says to like Teeny of like, oh yeah, there was another party in which there are two men and he was having fun before he joined in. And Celia goes from like being this like rebellious, like shit together girl to like a broken mass by the end, who's like, I need to leave. I need to get out of here, because she's been doing what? To be able to get to see her mom in Cardenas and get out of the school. And that's what I was saying, like they destroy her. She's eaten up by the system, whereas Ignacio is sort of groomed into a different sort of role, which is also very like sexist and horrible and weird.
Quite. Yeah. I think the magic of Sara Mesa's book is that she doesn't tell, you know, everything. And I couldn't do that. You know, when I write, you know, very basic and blah, 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 like a, you know, like a truck until the end. But very like, you know, she's like mysterious and you can read between lines. And, you know, there's a double reading, which is very interesting because you can imagine all different paths the novel can take, and you don't know, you know, and that's a mystery that's very difficult to create, you know. I think that's very worthy. I mean,
oh yeah, and very difficult to translate, I would think, to have to be able to retain that precision. Whereas, I mean, especially coming from Spanish, it's easy to like keep a lot of words because of all the connecting words and the different like articles and whatnot. Like it's easier to like just keep all that, and the sentences become sort of long and clunky, whereas that's not what her writing is. So like, that's why a lot of the refinement to this is in that sort of shaving away, making it very direct, leaving it like semi-ambiguous, but like not confusing.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Because I think there are similarities the way she writes to poetry, because she chooses the right word every time, you know. That's very difficult. I mean, I don't know many writers who can, you know, write in that way that, you know, it's the proper word every time, you know.
Yeah.
And then, of course, in a translation, I'm not a translator, but I guess it must be difficult to get the real sense of what she was trying to say in the sentence, no?
Yeah, and make sure that it comes off in English, because that was one of the bigger challenges with this section was the kids' voices, to make sure that they didn't sound like too slangy or like fake slangy, like we're trying to imitate TikTok, but also not make it sound stilted like it was a translation. So that's where like the reading aloud thing made a big difference, is like how they speak sounds natural. And like, and that was the one thing I have to tell you, that was the thing that listening to the audiobook, I was the most concerned about going in. Like going in, I was like, we thought we really nailed the idea of speech and what it sounds like and how it sounds natural. And I was like, now I'm gonna hear someone else read it. And that, I could have been way wrong. Like we could have been thinking it sounds natural, but it doesn't. But the reading on the audiobook sounded completely natural too. Like, so I'm really, congratulations or kudos to Katie for being able to pull that off. But it does seem very smooth. And that is a trick of translation.
Yeah, but that's tricky because imagine that, I don't know, Sara or any other Spanish writer makes a character with a Southern accent. And how do you do that in English? I mean, what accent do you put? Like a redneck accent? No.
The answer is no. The answer is a firm, hard no. Anytime you try and map accents from one language onto like the dialect of the dialects of the other, it won't work. It just won't. It will not work. It'll come off wrong. But there was, I did a panel with translator Michael Henry Heim, who translated from like 13 different languages. He was a real pure genius, like true language genius. Very, very good person. He passed away some years ago now. But in the panel, I had to interview him about this Günter Grass book that he translated, in which every chapter has a person from a different part of Germany with a different accent. And they weren't like wickedly distinctive. Like they were like overlapped, but you could tell like the shifts of who they were. And so I asked him about it, and he wrote up before our panel, he wrote this whole list of guidelines on how to create your own imaginary dialects and like what things you could use. So like if the dialect's supposed to be like, you say Southern and then connected it with redneck, if it's supposed to be like someone who's like uneducated, poor, removed from society, then you use certain, like you script, use ain't, you script like grammar in certain ways. There's like things that you do to like tone it. So it sounds like, it almost sounds like it's a dialect, but it's not specifically a dialect. Mm-hmm. And I think, I mean, you have to be really smart to do that and like really good with words. But like, I think that that's the best way to do it. Trying to map it on anything else is like, whew, it always sounds dated. It always sounds
like, you get in trouble. Huh?
Yeah. See, I can see a lot of instances where that gets you in a lot of trouble very quickly. So then Celia goes away, vanishes. We know that she's been replaced. We don't know what's really happened to her, but she's been expelled. Maybe she committed suicide. Maybe she ran away and got to Cardenas. It's like left ambiguous, which is one of the cool parts and why this works so well. And then, like I said at the beginning, that's where we get then to find out that Hector replaced her, and he's not a special, and he sets everything off. The balance is off now. He's a student that's repeating his first year. He's another so that's not balanced. He doesn't fit in with the specials, so the numbers don't work, but there's still just 200 students at the school at all points in time that are broken apart. And then he has his semi-abusive relationship with Ignacio. One of my favorite things about Ignacio is like how he's like, how he's obsessed with telepathy.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't know why, but hearing it, like reading it this time, I was just like, I really like that. Like he brings it up a lot where he's just like, I'm sending signals or like.
Like superpowers. Yeah, that's true.
I'm too far away to get his telepathic messages.
Ignacio is quite nuts, right? And Hector tried to fit in by, you know, I don't know, I guess submitting as a slave or something, you know, in a way.
Yeah. You know? No, I think that's it. Like, he's like, yeah, Ignacio gives in to like being the dominated person, the dominated party, the submissive party. And that thinking that will work for him. So like they try, it's two different tacks of trying to fit into a situation in which the power structure is not on your side. So he rebels against it and tries to manipulate the system and gets ground up. And Ignacio is like, well, I'll submit to it, and submits to it to the point where like they just give up on him. Like the fact that Hector just like doesn't give a shit about him at all is like the big turning point.
But then, and then the relation between the director and Miss Culo is what intrigues me more, you know, because they have this sadomasochist relation. With, I don't know.
That was like, we kept pitching this book as we kept it for the elevator pitch for this book was, it was like Shirley Jackson's Hangs a Man meets Jeffrey Epstein.
I saw the documentary the other day in Netflix.
Oh, did you watch it? I haven't watched it yet, but like.
A crazy guy. I mean, oh, come on.
Pure evil. Fuck all of this world of.
A lot of people who is involved in all this shit, you know, powerful people. I mean, that's, you know, I think he was killed because, you know, too many things he knew, you know.
I believe it.
Let's leave it here because otherwise they're gonna kill us too.
Yeah. my daughter was talking about like going to all the different protests and all cops are bastards and all like the normal like overthrow the government stuff, and all of a sudden now every time we talk Siri comes on, is like, can I help you, on her phone. I'm like, we didn't say anything that would have triggered that, like that just came on. So I'm convinced, yeah, we shouldn't say too much. We're on a Google owned platform. Although I saw this great joke this morning that was like the most Baudrillard joke I've heard in a long time, where on Twitter someone was like, I'm just gonna describe aloud an imaginary rug that I would like to have for my room so that it'll be heard by Alexa and I will get a very targeted ad for this rug like the next day or two. And it's like, shit, we live in a world in which you create illusions that then illusionarily give you that illusion that you are looking for. Like, that's crazy.
Like the simulacra is getting real, no? We get to the simulacra.
It dictates us now. We're all there. But
Matrix. It's dangerous. Yeah. That's why I don't have Twitter or Instagram. You know, I did an interview last day in Instagram and the camera didn't work and I just delayed the application, you know, because it's like, you know, I'm not posting photos of myself anyway. What I'm gonna do here, you know?
No, you don't need it. Don't need it. The Twitter, you definitely don't need it.
But anyway, yeah, the relation between the director and Miss Culo, it's intriguing because, you know, she wants something from the director, but the director, you know, he has a wife, and then he only wants to, you know, somehow, you know, how do you say that in English? Like treat like shit.
Yeah. Is cool,
no? And she's like there, like waiting for, you know, approbation and, you know, and sex and whatever. And
it seems like they don't, I mean, I assume at some point they do have sex, but in here, a lot of the descriptions are like, not that. Like, she's like forced to stand there naked and he's like snorting coke.
Yeah, it's more like a voyeur, no? Like a voyeur, can you say that?
Yeah. Like a voyeur or like some sort of dominant, submissive BDSM sort of setup. In which he's like the master, but that's also it's very intriguing because like what is she trying to get out of that is always sort of compelling.
Cool. That's the best place to do these kind of games, right but then all these sexual games, it seems that, you know, it seems that reflects also in the students too, because then Hector and Ignacio has this, you know, kind of raping almost, you know, sexual awakening, strange and violent, you know. So it's strange that in all points of this hierarchy, from the director to the students, there is this sexual strange relations.
Absolutely. One of the dumbest but funniest and probably my favorite family stories that I know is that my dad's cousin, maybe something like that, she was a school teacher, and she and the principal were having an affair, and they got caught fucking in the principal's office by the janitor, and it was just like in this tiny little town in Wisconsin. So it was like front page news. Like, my cousin was having an affair with the principal and like caught banging, and like I love that. I'm there for that. That seemed appropriate. That is a post family story of the top level.
No, but this is also a subject that it's very quite common in the campus novels and college novels, which is that if the teacher has the power, you know, and also happens in the real world, a lot of teachers who has the power and has the place to do the speech, you know, and then you have all these students half in love with you, even if you're super ugly, but you are the mastermind of this class. So you have this, you know, power on your students, and then you can also take advantage of him, of this situation. And that happens in the real life too.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
It's power really
more than way more than we know and way more than it should.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a solid reckoning here for a little while of like during the Me Too movement of professors and people at universities that were abusing their power. But even like there's a famous case here at the University of Rochester where we're based, and the professor's still a professor. He did a lot of really bad shit and like got away with it because he's tenured. So he's still there, he's still teaching, and it's like, it's pretty despicable. But
this also appears in a lot of campus novels of, for example, I don't know if you read Disgrace by Coetzee.
Oh, I haven't, but I want to. It's really? Like on my shelf endlessly.
But it's also about a teacher who has a relation with the student. But then there is also a racial issues in South Africa. It's a very interesting novel too. But it seems here in the Sara novels, Sara Mesa novel, there is no such a thing. There is no, at least until now, like a teacher who tries to fail in. Maybe, I don't know, because we have this director who, you know, who pet some students, you know, and this could be like a kind of a homosexual sadomasochist game too, or something. I don't know. Power relation.
I don't want to give too much away at all. So I'm going to try and hold this back, because we usually do it like by bits. And since you haven't read the next parts, it's really anything to like play off of. But there is like that is a big issue. So with the teacher, the role of the teachers and how they relate to the students is like a key. And if you have a stand-in at any point in time, because so far the headmaster is abusing the booty and Harrison was what I was going to say, but Ignacio. And then the assistant headmaster, or the advisor, I mean, the advisor is with Celia and is clearly like abusing her in some sexual ways. And there's one other teacher, is the new teacher that comes in, that's the girl that Ignacio is jealous of, the woman, because Hector seems to pay attention to her and she's pretty and like seems to have all their things, and he's pissed at her and is like jealous of her. And that's the only other possible adult that could be like proactively protecting the children or doing something. But that will, all these things will play out.
There's a lot of shit going on.
There's a lot of shit going on, but we don't know exactly what it is either. There was one, so listen to it again too. Like there's one time where there are a bunch of words that are in there that are like very meaningful and chosen for a specific way, specific reason, but there's one time it references disposable. And that's a key word for this whole book, is what's disposable and like what can be disposed of. That's like a key premise that will make sense. The statement will make sense for anyone listening who hasn't read the full book by the end of the book, but that was one that I almost positive it might not be in the Spanish, or if it is, it's like an option, but we inserted it into here for a very specific reason so that it would resonate throughout the whole text. And it's in this section directly. Let's see if you can find it. I think the booty says it. She says like it says it's in her term, or it's like she makes herself disposable to him.
Oh yeah, but it must be in the Spanish version too.
I think it's something different in the Spanish. I think it's a slightly different word, but it means essentially the same thing, but it was like slightly different, and we just tweaked that. Yeah, because the translations like are never literal. I mean, they can never be literal. They're new creations. Sort of like how Mara created the voices for your book. Like they're the same, but they're not literally the same. And that's some of the things that make translation fun and make a good translation a good translation, I think.
Personally. Well, I mean, a good translation, for example, when sometimes I'm more influenced by books that that had been translated into Catalan language, for example, from another language, but the translator uses a very creative translation.
Yeah.
And that helped me in order to write a different Catalan literary language. And it can happen also the other way. Like, for example, Mara Lethem's book, no? She created this English, and maybe somebody read this book in the United States and say, oh, I like this English, you know, and maybe I can use some words too, you know. That's why it's important, like a creative a translation, it's not literal, no? That
the
translator becomes also a writer, and it has this capacity to...
Absolutely. The translator has to be a writer, and like in a lot of ways, like an interpreter, like their interpretation of what that where the accents need to be, where like the beats in the story, like the way that like it's tonally framed, and like the moods that are created, and the way that it's cast, like that interpretation on the translator's part gets reflected in the translation and really makes a good, like someone who's a really good reader and interpreter and good writer, that makes a great translator. Like, and if you're missing out on parts of those, you can sometimes feel it. Like, it's just it doesn't sing, or it's like, wait, what is happening? This doesn't feel like the right emphases are in the right place. Like, it feels like something's off sometimes.
Also, if you read different translations from one book, let's say, for example, Ulysses from James Joyce, and you read like a translation from Mexico or Argentina or Spain, you have completely different books, you know. And it's very, you know, it's amazing because suddenly you have five different Ulysses and you can pick from every one of them, you know. It's very interesting. Yeah.
There's one time, God, what is his name? He runs Restless Books now, and he writes a lot. Alain Stebanz was giving a presentation, and he was talking about doing that with Don Quixote, of having like each of the different translations have one chapter, have a monster Quixote that's one chapter of each of the different translations.
I talked with Alain, because I was doing a research about Spanish language, uh-huh. I found a lot of books about Spanglish from him. So I wrote him an email and say, hey, look, I want to meet you. And, you know, I want to talk about all this because I'm really interested in that language because it's a creation of a new language, you know, which doesn't happen in Spain because we are very attached to the rules of the language, you know. And so when a new language appears, because two cultures get this fusion and then, you know, you have this slang in the street and they create a new language and it's like, whoa, that's very interesting in a literary level, you know, you can use it. And yeah, I think Ilan is doing a great job with all his books and the researching. And yeah, he even translated The Little Prince into Spanglish.
Oh yeah, that's right. I have a question for you about that. So like with the different languages and different sort of like blending of things and finding new ways, new modes of expression seems to play a lot to Adventures and Misadventures and to your interests in general. How does that work with like Catalan literature and Catalan language in Spanish or Castilian? Like, I feel like the Castilian, most of the books that seem much more formal or rigid, like you're saying, follow the rules, and the Catalan stuff seems to be a little bit looser. But I think this is a big
in a language level, or you mean?
I'm thinking of it more at an art level, like the literary, like novelistic level.
Well, I don't know. Probably, I mean, here in Catalonia, we had like a very powerful poetry tradition, mm-hmm. which connect in the beginning of the 20th century to the avant-garde in Europe. Mostly French, but Dadaism also, and all these, and all these forms of avant-garde poetry. I think some of these could drop also into some novelists, especially the 70s novelists, and some of them now, but not many. But all these influence from Europe, the avant-garde in Spain, didn't have much of effect, you know. And I think that's one of the reasons of that the novel in Spain is more classic than in Catalonia, you know. That's my opinion. I'm not an expert in peninsular literature, but that could be one explanation, you know.
The 2 month review is 100% committed to not having experts in anything. We have no expertise.
Well, I'm an expert in campus novel, but that's it.
Yeah, you're an expert in campus novels. You are the first expert to be on this show. No, other people, yeah. The guests are experts. The guests could be experts. Like the baseline shit that Brian and I say, definitely not expert. You were talking to me about Osvaldo Lamborghini before, right?
Oh, yeah. I love Osvaldo. Yeah. You should translate it and publish, man. That's a golden mine.
One of his books is coming out.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I can't find it now, but I got an email about it. I meant to email it to you, and I'm not finding it, but I will, and I'll update you.
So you're going to publish him?
No, someone else already bought the rights to it.
Well, he made a novel, which is called Tadeis, and the other things are short stories. He didn't write much, but this novel is completely crazy. It's very also, again, like Gargantua, you know, but in a modern way. I mean, for me, I compare Lamborghini to Louis Ferdinand Céline, for example. You know, this kind of writer, which has a very powerful way of speaking, you know. You can read that and you can hear all loud in your ears, you know, because he's inventing also a language and it's very interesting. It's very interesting. And this guy lived in Barcelona and he was like underground. And just a few years ago, it has been like a, you know, put it on the right way, but probably because he doesn't have much of things write down, you know, yeah. He didn't write much. There's, I hope they don't sell it like Roberto Bolaño, you know.
Yeah.
had like the new Beatnik or something. Well, I don't know. For me, Lamborghini is much, much better than Bolaño, but you know, it's a matter of taste.
I think it was a small press that was doing it. I'll find it. I'll find it and post the information. What's funny, if I when I search my email for Lamborghini, I get a message from 2010, from January 5th, my daughter's birthday, 2010, that's from a guy named Stuart, and it's the subject is via my friend Jessica, re Osvaldo Lamborghini, and it's all about introducing me to his work. And I asked him about it and said that we should talk about an editorial meeting. And then I don't think anything happened. We have no, there's no sample or anything. There's just like a paragraph being like, he's cool.
Mm. Well, there's another author from Argentina, which I'm totally crazy about him, which is Alberto Laiseca. And he also is kind of underground even there. He's already dead, but he wrote many books. And but one of the books, particularly crazy, it's called, in English, I don't know how to translate, but it's like the worm, the giant worm of the life itself.
Oh, wow.
Doesn't make much sense, but it's about a worm, a giant worm who goes in New York raping girls and making friends. You know, it's totally crazy. It's like Pynchon, but in LSD, you know, or something, or in cocaine or something. I don't know. It's really crazy. Yeah. I don't know. Translated into English, I don't think so, but maybe I don't know.
Yeah, you'll have to email me that so I can look that. Well, that sounds particularly crazy. Do you know? Oh my God, I'm blanking on his name. I'm not gonna be able to find it. We did an anthology called A Thousand Forests and One Acorn. Do you know Valerie Miles?
No.
Okay, she lives in Barcelona, and she's a major like editor and writer, like reviewer, critic, and all sorts of things. She helped put together A Thousand Forests and One Acorn, this anthology for us that was like based on a certain number. It was all living writers in Spanish from all over the world. They picked out the best thing they had ever written. They did an interview, and one of them was Elvio Gandolfo. Have you ever heard of Elvio Gandolfo?
Where is he from?
I want to say Argentina. Definitely Argentina.
Well, I mean, Argentina has a lot of, you know, real good writers. They have a big culture. I mean, I was there last year, and I was amazed how people love books, you know.
Yeah.
And young people, old people, everybody, you know. And much more than in Spain. Much, much, much more. That's and, amazing. You know, they have a culture. Like amazing culture of books, you know. I was astonished. Another author which is very interesting is Aurora Venturini. I don't know if you heard about.
Yes.
She's really good. She's really probably she's dead, but when she got famous, she was already very old. But she used to write like a young radical writer, you know. She won a literary award, and people of the jury thought there was a young teenager who wrote that, and he was like 70 years old, and he's so modern, you know. You read that and he's like what you, it blows your mind, you know. Yeah, I mean, Argentinians, yeah, well, they have a really good writers there.
I'm going to send you the story about Elvio Gandolfo, and I'm starting to think that as well. I can't remember at this moment because this book was from like 7 years ago, and my memory is like, I feel like Mark seems like it was like a million years ago. Everything else is like so far in the past. But anyways, this is great. It's great to like get all the recommendations of all these authors too, to like look into or to read for ones that have been translated to look into too, that for people who are interested in these sort of books.
Yeah. I mean, there's always writers, and I think the best writers are always the most unknown, you know, because the most unknown, they are more free to write whatever they want. They don't have the pressure like, oh, I have to win this award or I have to be famous. So they write whatever they want, you know. And yep. I like these kind of writers.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, I'm a big, obviously a big Pynchon fan. I don't know if I can get this on there.
Yeah.
So I'm into that sort of thing for sure. Oh, and someone that's watching mentioned that Pynchon and LSD. Damn, that sounds like a great combination.
Well, Pynchon is already LSD, but anyway, so he's Argentinian. It's like double dope, you know.
Here's one last one for you that if you know this author, I'll be surprised, but it's the Spanish author, Alyocha Cole. Nope. Okay. I'll send you information. He died very, very young, killed himself, but he had decided to like only write a certain amount of things. And we're going to be doing his last novel called Attila, which he killed himself immediately thereafter. But it, he believed that like Finnegan's Wake was like the starting point for literature.
Well, yeah, it could be.
And then went up there.
That's a good point then. We should read it.
It's wild. Yeah, it was like the one book that Carmen, the one author that Carmen Balcells before she died, she said was the one thing that she failed at was getting him to be.
When was published that? When?
It was in the 70s. And then it was, and then the one of them was published past, that might be lying about that. Someone should have to correct me. I'll look, but it was like the 70s, 80s, I believe.
Yeah.
And he died in 1990. So he wrote all his books then, and there was one that came out afterwards that was Attila was like published posthumously, obviously, because he killed himself right afterwards. But he was the one author that Carmen couldn't place, and she claimed that it was because of the consolidation of the industry to be less experimental and less like free and more corporate. He doesn't fit that. He started from the point of like ultimate freedom and tried to explore like the idea of what is possible within a book. Like this book opens with like a play. It is very like Joycean.
Mm-hmm. Well, I like that. I mean, I have the same, you know, ideology, and that's why I publish my books in an independent, you know, publishing houses, because I think this is the only way to go against the system, you know, which is only made by big corporations who it's like a wormhole who, you know, sucks all the little publishing houses until everything looks the same. Yep. And it's true. Nowadays, it's very difficult to find books that blows your mind, you know, because all tends to uniform. Not only here, everywhere in the world. That's globalization. And people wear the same haircuts, the same shoes, write the same books, you know, the same movies. And that's horrible because then, you know, it's like if you have a twin, you know, which must be like looking at the mirror every day, which must be horrible, you know, all the time. And I think, you know, art should be to try to find different things, precisely, you know, the difference, and to create different worlds. And if everything looks the same, then, you know, we're done.
And that's a civilization. To tie that into Sara's book into 4x4, that is what I like the best about her, is that it isn't told like a way that the normal like Iowa writers workshops to make like a stereotype from America would be, where it's like telling things in a particular way. She's broken it up into these fragments. They're misordered. Your footing is unsure as to like which timeline you're in. If you really look at it, there's a few instances where it could be Celia's timeline or it could be Ignacio's, but it's not 100% clear on which one it is. It could apply to both, but there's like, that's fun. And then the way that she shifts into part two and part three, totally different. And like, isn't following the like, oh, you just realistic, give it all on the surface, explain, you know, make it. This is like, no, you figure this shit out on your own. And I'm going to play around with ideas of form and writing as you do.
Of course. I mean, yeah. I think Sara Mesa is one of the young writers who broke to this with this tradition that we were talking about that happens in Spain, which the novel still is very traditional, you know, and that's a point, you know, to read her. I think that's very interesting. Yeah, to read, and it's a very interesting writer. Yeah. And I think for all the writers that are listening to this, they should never go to a writing school, because writing schools, and I was a teacher in one of them, but you know, writing schools, they tend to have a method. And so everybody learns how to write in the same way. So you got a formula. That's like the list when you do the list to go shopping, you know, and then you have all these books that look the same.
I went to one writing class when I was in college, and I was asked to remove myself from it because she's like, you know, the teacher who I had this like giant crush on was this TA. I was like, super like, wow, you're the most beautiful TA ever. So power structure, campus novel sort of thing. But she was like, no, you want to learn how to write things that are weird, and we're not going to be doing that. Like, we're doing like neo-real, we're doing realistic, you know, Raymond Carver. This is how it is. You want to do something else? She's like, I do not understand it. I don't know how this works. Like, I'm not going to help you.
But you see, that's very strange, because in the 70s, Pinchon, John Barth, and even in Spain, the novelists, or at least in Catalonia, you know, fiction was about super fiction. So to create another world inside this world, or imagine worlds or ways of languages, etc. And nowadays, there's a return of this realism, which I think is very, I don't know, anachronic. I don't know if this word is English.
And yeah, anachronistic.
Yeah, anachronistic and reactionary. I mean, it's like, you know, it's like when Jonathan Franzen says, oh, we should write again like Dostoevsky. What the fuck? Why? Yeah. Then I go to Dostoevsky directly. Why I have to write again like the realists in the 19th century? So what about the 20th century? What about Joyce? What about all these avant-garde? Oh, just blow it up?
No, too man. Hard. Too difficult. Doesn't make a good movie. Doesn't make a good movie. Every piece of intellectual property should be optioned for Netflix.
Yeah. I mean, all these realists for me sounds like, you know, that we are joining the Tea Party or something, you know? It's true.
Also, fuck Jonathan Franzen. I haven't said that on this podcast in a long time. So okay. you brought it back, and now you got to hit one of my favorite spots. So we usually end with like a favorite quote. But you should read a quote from like your in Spanish, what your favorite line is. And I'm going to quickly try.
Oh, I didn't choose it, but oh, I have something. Yeah, I think.
This is going to be tough because I didn't mark anything. This is the first time I don't have a book that's filled with notes, and I'm just trying to do it from memory.
Yeah. Well, normally I don't like to mark my books, but.
Oh, really? You're a non-marker? I'm a super marker.
You're a super marker?
Yeah, I mark everything. I don't want to forget things, and I have a really bad memory, so I like underline them, and then sometimes I just fold over pages, and I'll look at it and be like, what was that folded over for? And then I'll see like one line and be like, oh yeah, that's totally it. That's and now I remember. That seems like a thing I would have done.
So you can read first if you have to
mark. Yeah, I'm still looking. We got a banter here for a second. Maybe this one will not work this time, but see, there's so many good lines. There's so many good bits to this. The one I'm looking for has a very specific word in it. I'm not finding it. Actually, I'll just go with this because I flipped this. No, I'm not going to do that. There's so many good bits. It's so well crafted.
Also, when she says college here in the Spanish version, she said in a phonetic way.
Yes.
So it sounds like college in English, but it's written like phonetic. You know?
Oh, so you don't. So since you don't have it, here's how it is in here. It's college, like C O L I C H.
Mm-hmm. But I have C O L. Oh yeah, C O L I C H. Yeah.
Yep. True. Yeah, we use the same thing.
You use that in English too? Ah, okay.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely. Oh God, I don't know. Do you have a good one?
Well,
I do. This is because this ties into what I was talking about. So this is like one that just like is one of the things I think is so subtle. This what I like about this line, rather than it being like one of the funny ones that like just is like really dark or whatever that I usually choose. I'm going to choose this because it shows how subtle her writing is and how there's clues for you to pick up on if you want to. So on page 11, naturally, Vibrant College was not founded in 1943. The school is quite a bit newer than that. It is rumored to be no more than 15 years old, the same time frame, more or less, as the depopulation of Bado. And so out of nowhere, like that paragraph stands on its own and then goes with like the fact that it was built in the style of the 1940s doesn't mean anything, as one can easily imagine. But like you could go right past that paragraph and be like, doesn't whatever, just details. But it's actually like a really important point that this is a fake place, that they're not this established, great, gentrified boarding school that's been around since the 40s and saved all these children. Like that's bullshit. Like the thing is it's just an artifice. It is the simulacrum. It's a simulacrum of an English boarding school. Fuck me. I live in this thinking constantly and I can't get out of it.
Yeah, but think about it. The first universities, which was Cambridge, Oxford, and you know, in the 19th century, they were an old religious places, and they become then the governments. They turn these places into universities. So yeah. it's a fake place anyway. You know, it's not a real. All these places were meant for another thing. You know.
Yeah, exactly. And like the illusion, I'm gonna eventually people who are listening to this, and I'm going to write an article so I can stop fucking repeating myself over and over again. But it's the illusion that then creates the illusion. So like the idea of going to Harvard being like the key to get you into the upper echelon of the business world is just a way of propagating systems based on this idea of reputation.
Of course. I mean, in the States, the people who goes to Ivy League universities probably, you know, they're going to have better opportunities in life.
There's so many. Okay. I did not go to one of those universities.
Anyway. No, but I mean, it's the same here. The people who goes to private universities in Spain, probably they have all these connections to the high level society than the ones who goes to the public ones, you know. And that create already this class issue, you know, between the poor and the rich. Yeah. And that's going to be always like this, you know, and the system trains the people according what the system needs. So yeah. If the system needs, I don't know, technicians, because we live in a technical world, that's why, you know, subjects like literature and stuff like that doesn't matter anymore in the schools, you know. They don't care about books anymore.
Shit.
Scientists, you know, to build their, you know, shitty bombs or whatever. Yeah.
laser weapons. Laser weapons and phototonics
and things.
I work at a university. I'm well aware they don't care about arts and literature. They don't listen to this podcast. Do you have a favorite line?
Oh, I don't have a favorite line.
Fine, we'll leave it with mine.
But I can read some in
yes. Spanish. Yes.
Yeah, you want? Okay. Yeah. It's the chapter called Lux. Llega el gato y es un pequeño persa con la cara arrugada y únicamente la insinuación de una nariz, húmeda y achatada como una caca de rata. Yo hubiese preferido un gato romano, uno cualquiera de la calle. Pero un callejero siempre da más problemas, me dice el guía. Se iría al bosque y lo perderías enseguida. Este es un ejemplar único, genéticamente alterado para ser más manso y más chiquito. ¿No ves que apenas tiene uñas? Lo diseñaron para hacer compañía. Un gato callejero es un animal egoísta. Te utiliza, no te acompaña. No preferirías eso, ¿verdad? So, she talks about a little cat, a Persian cat, which is like a small like a rat. And she says, well, I would prefer a stray cat. Yeah. But then the guide says, no, but the stray cat always makes problems, you know, it's a troublemaker. So it's better this cat, which is genetically altered,
yeah,
to be more like domestic or not angry, you know?
Yep.
So, and that's also like you can compare that to the students who are there. They try to domesticate them, you know.
Yep.
In opposition to the stray cats, you know. So this book is about also about what we said, no? Like the education is also, institutional education is a way of domestication of, yeah.
Yeah, and that goes back to the freedom and protection.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So good. The one last thing I was going to say is, as we were talking about the illusion of the school being only seeming like it's old and established, that's another one of these weird power structure things of like it's presenting itself as being part of this upper echelon of society, but like, and then getting ex-ministers to send their kids there and pay for it because you're like in charge of things. There's mm-hmm. another power dynamics between their existence and like their PR in a sense.
Yeah, I mean, here that happens the same in for example, hospitals. People mm-hmm. pay for private hospitals thinking they are better or they give some cachet to it. But actually, public hospitals are better than the private. But still, rich people pay for the private because they are faster, but they are not necessarily better. So, you know, people who pay for, I don't know, Nike's shoes, you know, that's not necessarily a better shoe than a supermarket shoe. You just pay for the brand. And people look like idiots when they pay for things that they don't really need. Huh?
That's true. That's a trick. Yeah. Anyway, so next week we'll be covering pages 87 through 156, which is essentially the first half of A Substitute's Diary. And our special guest will be Derek Main. Theoretically, Brian will be back and living in Atlanta, which, you know, good luck to him. And I don't have anything else to add. Is there anywhere that people should go, aside from pre-ordering your book, which they're welcome to do in any place that they want to pre-order it, bookshop, through our website, through any of your local bookstores. But aside from that, is there anywhere that you want people to find you online?
Oh, you already can buy the book? I didn't know that.
You can pre-order it.
Oh, what does it mean that? So you pay it, but you have to wait?
Yeah, and when it comes out, it ships to you automatically.
Oh, okay. Well, then, I guess I'm going to buy it too.
Yeah. You'll get copies.
Oh, really? Oh, that's good. Okay, so I hope some people are going to buy it because I think they're going to laugh. I mean, I laugh when I was writing it, so, you know.
I can see that. When I first got Mara's translation, I started reading it one night. There was like 20 minutes of just hysterical laughing. And I talked to our marketing person. He's like, this is the funniest book we've ever published. And I was like, yeah, I know it is. It's like, it's there. Well, part jokes, less of part jokes I'm there for. Like, yeah, it's there. Yeah.
So yeah, like humor, farts, all these things, you're going to find that in the book.
Everything. So thanks for listening. Thanks for coming on. This has been really fun.
It was a pleasure. And we're driving fast till we run out of gas.